It's so wonderful to see so many people out. Welcome to this second Sunday of Easter, and it's also Communion Sunday. Welcome to everyone online. Camera's coming. They can probably hear me though, but now they can see me waving. It'll come up eventually. And welcome to everyone in person. Welcome to those who are visiting. And do I see any unfamiliar faces? I see a couple. So just to let you know that we sit, for most of it, we stand when we sing the hymns. So if you follow mostly the choir, you'll be fine. And if you stand when you're sitting or sit when you're standing, don't worry about it. We all go up and down. All the responsive prayers and the hymns will be up on the screen, so you don't have to worry about looking in the book. And for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be looking at what happened after the resurrection, how the disciples responded, how did they act and engage with the gift they were given. For those of you who are online, I'd invite you to prepare, if you'd like to join us in the Sacrament of Communion, to prepare your bread and a cup of juice so that you can join us. And because it's the first Sunday of the month, we celebrate birthdays and anniversaries. So I already know Wendy Mel's birthday was this week. I know Kent is coming up. Jackie, who's not here, and Michael, who I'm not allowed to say, I didn't tell you. And me! Are there other birthdays in April? Caden was on Thursday, and Al? Oh, you were repeating the same thing. Any other April birthdays? So there's Wendy, Kent, Jackie, Michael, Caden, and me. All right, Michael? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to Wendy, Kent, and Jackie, and Michael, and me. Happy birthday to you. God's blessings on you all, and me. Do we have any anniversaries this month? I know we have at least one, and it's their 50th anniversary. Are there any other anniversaries? Well, Lorna and Rodolfo, I'd invite you to stand where you are, and you will put your hands like this to receive the blessing, and we will offer the blessing this way. So Lorna and Rodolfo will be renewing their vows of their 50th wedding anniversary here on April 27th. So let us, and the words are, no, you can stay standing, and you're going to have your hands like this. And the words are, may the blessing of the Lord be upon you. We bless you in the name of the Lord. And it just repeats. May the blessing of the Lord be upon you. We bless you in the name of the Lord. May the blessing of the Lord be upon you. We bless you in the name of the Lord. God's blessings on you both. And on, we can do this. So I just thought I'd start our service with a bit of humor. How the bunny became part of Easter. Can you see that? Can you see that? Can you see that? All right, let us worship, and I'll invite Wendy up to share the news with us.
Good morning, everyone. Now, actually, Patty Murphy was going to be doing the announcements, and she kindly wrote out what she thought we would like to know about. So I'm going to read what she wrote. We acknowledge the passing of two dear members of the Merging Water family, Frances Blenkhorn on March 19th in her 94th year, and Frances Whipple on February 23rd in her 84th year. We share your sadness, and please read about there are obituaries in the midweek message with details. And take a moment to view the variety of photos from a slew of Easter events held in the lead up last week. For Lisa and Men, she performed six, count them, six services. It is evident that our community really knows how to pitch in. Thank you to those that organized, participated, helped out, and documented with your picture taking. And from Jan, as you start your spring cleaning, please remember that Boutique 24 is looking for quality, clean, gently used clothing in particular. And we could use men's clothing and children's items also. Gladly accept bedding, linens, etc. You can drop off your items on Wednesdays from 1 to 3 or Thursdays from 11:30 to 3:30. And we are still doing a collecting of bread tags, pill bottles, and pop can tabs. They can be deposited downstairs to the entrance of the boutique. Another interesting event coming up at St. Jenny's is a Resurrect Your Bike and a plant sale, and that's being held on April 21st and on the 28th of April at 2 p.m. Got some curiosity about what really happens at a murder mystery dinner? Find out about this and other fun events in our West Island cluster in the Merging Waters Midweek Message. Finally, get a taste of what the budding classical musicians of the Lakeshore Chamber Music Group have for you right here this afternoon at 2 p.m. It's a student concert that is free with a goodwill offering. And Susan Hawker is going to give us a little bit of an update about the soup pot cinema and also the contra dance party.
It was a very busy, busy weekend here at the church. On Friday night, we had our soup pot. We had a good crowd, and we showed the movie Call Jane, and it was very well, a lot of positive comments. It's a strong, hard movie, but it was very powerful and very pertinent given the current situation with Roe versus Wade in the States. And last night, you won't believe it, but there were 94 people clapping their hands and dancing in Adair Hall. It was fabulous. There were so many young students and babies. There were three or four babies and young kids. It was, and the joy, music, it was fabulous. There was Bill Gossage, Mike Blahow, and Glenn Moy playing the music, and we had a caller, and we learned all sorts of interesting, fun steps. So it was a lot of fun, and I guess we'll have to do it again. So thank you for, I see some faces that were there last night. Take care.
Thank you, Susan. It's a time in our service where we acknowledge the peoples on whose land we stand. And knowing the history of this land is really a key step in our journey towards reconciliation. Many of you are excited about the upcoming eclipse that's happening tomorrow. What you may or may not know is that its significance also extends beyond astronomy. Centuries ago, the five nations that formed the Haudenosaunee Confederacy came together to formulate the Great Law of Peace, and we've talked a bit about that in the past. But the event that occurred at the same time was a solar eclipse. And ever since then, the solar eclipse has been a reminder to all of the Haudenosaunee peoples of their union as a greater tribe. And you can see, I'll be sending out in the midweek some links if you want to read more about how it ties into Indigenous history. And you can see that this week. So we gather this morning on land in St. Anne de Bellevue. Many names, many peoples, many generations. One place. In honor of all who have come before us, may we never forget the history of this land. And together we say, in hope that all the people after us may know the true history of this land, may we weave these stories into our lives as people who call this place home. We are all sacred people, beloved children of the Holy One. May we treat one another as such in truth and reconciliation. Amen. If you're at home, now's the time that you can light your candle with us. Christ, who rolled away the stone, Christ, who bears the mark of love, grant us peace as we live in your light and open our eyes to see your light among us. Amen. Our musical centering this morning is a little bit different from those of you that downloaded the bulletin online. I'm going to invite Michael to lead us in the Trumpet Voluntary by John Travers. I wasn't sure there for a second. Amen. Let us join together in our call to worship. Christ has risen. Hallelujah. Christ has risen. We gather to worship the risen Christ, conqueror of death. Hallelujah. Let's try that again. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. All right. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. We lift up praise to the risen Christ, Redeemer of all life. Alleluia! Christ is risen. We give thanks to the risen Christ, Giver of the Holy Spirit. Alleluia! Christ is risen. Christ has risen. Christ has risen indeed. Yeah, it's good news, you know. Let us pray. O resurrected Christ, the one who has overcome death and doors alike, we recognize that any gathering of believers is truly sacred. Fill this space with your abundant joy and send out any hint of scarcity. God, we know that you meet us exactly where we are. We thank you for coming to us in the way that we need. When our faith is shaky and we say, unless I see, you come to us with outstretched hands, hands and sides which bear the marks of your sacrifice for us. You give us unconditional love, unwavering presence, and abundant grace. In return, we give you faith that is not perfect, but enmeshed with our humanity. And even though this can never be enough, you take it gladly. We offer you all that we have to give. Take our lives, our time, and our talents, and may we not keep anything behind closed doors from you. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is from More Voices, number 94. Love Knocks and Waits. And Wendy, Jeff and Wendy, I invite you to come up.
Evening came on the first day of the week. It was the same day the tomb was found empty.
The disciples were terrified. They had locked themselves into the house, fearing those who might come in. They had been part of a movement that was supposed to change everything. They had hoped for a Messiah. Instead, their leader had died on the cross.
Jesus had suffered and died, and they had supported him. Would they be next? Would their fate be the same? They were frightened, unable to know what to do next.
Just then, Jesus came and stood among them, inside the room where the doors were locked.
He said, "Peace be with you." As they looked at him, astonished, confused, afraid, and in disbelief, he held out his hands and he showed them his side. The marks from his ordeal, they were quite visible.
The disciples were amazed. It was Jesus.
Jesus said again, "Peace be with you. As God has sent me, so I send you."
Jesus took a deep breath and exhaled on them.
"Receive the Holy Spirit," Jesus said. "If you forgive the sins of any, they will be forgiven. But if you're not able to forgive, not able to let go, then they will not be forgiven.
Thomas was not there that night. This disciple, who had been active in Jesus' ministry, was missing when Jesus returned to them.
The other disciples tried to tell him what they had seen. They wanted him to understand that what Jesus had foretold had come true. They kept telling him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas didn't believe them.
Thomas said, "Unless I can see the mark of the nails in his hands, I won't believe what you've said. Unless I can see the side where they pierced him in the end, I can't know for sure it was him. I want to touch him. I want the same proof you received."
A week went by. The disciples still tried to convince Thomas, and he still would have none of it. They gathered together again in the house, and this time Thomas was there.
Again, the doors were closed, and Jesus appeared among them. "Peace be with you," he declared. Thomas looked at him. Jesus looked at Thomas and said, "Here, touch the place in my hands where they drove the nails. Place your hand in my side where they pierced me with the sword. Don't doubt, but believe. It is I."
Thomas cried out to Jesus, "My Lord and my God."
Jesus asked Thomas the question, "Do you believe because you have seen me? There will be others who will believe without seeing me. They will also be blessed."
Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name.
May God grant understanding to the holy words told in this story. Thank you. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth, the thoughts, the wanderings and the wrestlings of our heart bring us ever closer to you, O God. Amen. Now you can tell from how we read the story, my focus was going to reflect on Thomas's bravery. But thanks to Susan and Helen and Jim and 94 people last night, my sermon had to be rewritten in the early hours of the morning. That's why I was late to choir practice, Michael, I'm sorry. Christ sends, but do we still linger within our walls, behind closed doors? Christ unifies, yet do we stand divided on politics, on war, on love? Love knocks on the door. For what do we wait? The season of Easter is a season of new life, new birth, hallelujahs, alleluias that are happily said, yeah. It's filled with the excitement of what God has done and is doing. We do not stay quiet. Instead, we are sent to proclaim and to continue the physical acts of Christ here on earth. At the beginning of John 20, the disciples, they're gathered behind locked doors. Likely, the glow of the lanterns was really dim. You can just imagine it. Mary Magdalene had told the disciples of what she'd seen in the garden that morning. And they're now really fearful of how the Jewish authorities might respond to Jesus' missing body. Appearing to them, the light of the world must make his presence known. And he came with a message, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." Sent, not only to proclaim the gospel and the message of forgiveness, but to grant forgiveness themselves. And possessing the power of the Holy Spirit, they begin to do this work. However, this was a community that wrestled with belief. They wrestled with faith. How could they forget the last 3 years of walking alongside Jesus, seeing, experiencing, tasting, touching the miracle of life and love that Jesus shared with them? How could they hide behind those doors? What about the followers of Oscar Romero or Martin Luther King or Mahatma Gandhi? Did they forget? Do we easily forget? Are we taking up the mission of love that knocks on the door? I think so. Last night, I had this epiphany. Susan mentioned this morning we had our first contra dance since before the pandemic, and we weren't even sure if we were going to have a good turnout. I think we had about 20 tickets sold or something like that. And when some people arrived, they were actually kind of disappointed because they didn't see many cars parked along the street. Well, that's because the people who came were our neighbors. They walked here between the ages of 3 months and 80 plus. This house was filled with sounds of joy. They walked from their homes to engage with us, an evening with just under 100 neighbors. Toddlers, teens, young adults, elders filled that hall with joy. Many of the people there last night had never even stepped foot in our church, in any of our spaces. Some were newer people who've been coming to our church who brought a whole bunch of friends. I thought that was really cool. It was like that old shampoo commercial. Now I'm going to age myself. You know the one that says, and they told two friends, and so on, and so on? Anybody remember that? Oh, phew. Watching everyone last night and talking with so many incredible people, I asked them, you know, what brought them here? Because I wanted to know, you know, was it our posters? Was it our, you know, signs on social media? Was it friends or what was it? And again, I realized what a blessed and sacred gift Merging Waters offers to both those inside and outside our walls. And I started writing down some of the things we do. Pastoral care, music, arts, community, film, food, fellowship, dance, advocacy, meditation, yoga, tai chi, outreach. I wrote that twice. Oh, okay. Social justice, environment, an affirming community, learning about anti-racism, learning to decolonize, indigenous allyship, basic needs with the boutique, food security, recycling, repurposing, theological reflection, and social justice. And I'm sure there's more, but I had to sleep eventually. And then I thought, oh, this was my list that I doodled on last night. There are many community organizations in St. Anne's that are doing mostly all of what you see up there. But what's unique about Merging Waters, that was good, is that we offer it through the lens of spiritual care. That is unique to Merging Waters. Music, arts, yoga, all of that stuff invites the community into a spiritual journey where they can be their authentic selves, where they can show up as their authentic selves, into a community of believers and non-believers and people struggling on that path where all can find a path and a connection for their highest good. Love knocks, and we respond. So how do we continue to share this news beyond our walls, and how can we make explicit and visible our mission of love in a world that so desperately needs it? Thomas, dear Thomas, we know the story. Heck, we even coined the phrase, the doubting Thomas. But what if we heard him through another lens? Maybe when Mary shared the news with the disciples, he went out to tell the good news instead of saying behind locked doors. Would we look at Thomas differently in that light? Would we perhaps think of him as a brave soul who dared to go out and share with the world? I see so many in this community, and I'm looking at all of you. Yes, you too, Jim, hiding behind the Zoom. I see so many who are the brave Thomases, working behind the scenes, going out into the world and sharing the good news in their unique ways, volunteering, serving in community organizations that make an impact, creating ripples of love that go beyond the doors of this church. How can we continue to be a Thomas when love knocks and waits for us to respond? In closing, in our book study that we're doing, The Wall Between, which talks about both the Jewish and the Palestinian narrative in the light of peace and breaking down that wall between, all of us in the group are really struggling with the reality of truths that most of us have been oblivious to. Truths and stories and lives that had no voice in the greater societal narrative. This week, as our group meets to look at glimpses of hope amid the chaos, the genocide, and the war and trauma, we're going to need your prayers. We're going to need your prayers to support us and guide us into being the Thomases of today, to be brave and go out and share those truths that we're learning, the good news that love is stronger than hate and love is stronger than fear, that we can make a difference. And even if it's just a tiny drip, that drip becomes a ripple, that ripple becomes a wave. As we close this time of reflection, I'd invite you to think on three things. Where are you individually being called or being sent to today? Or the other side of that, what doors are keeping you from venturing out to share the resurrection news? Take a moment to reflect on something that is cutting you off from being fully connected to God. It might be something you struggle with, something you're holding on to, or part of your life that does not include God. Focus on that. And I'd invite you to think of that and focus on this light. As we say together, I bring this to the light. One, two, three. I bring this to the light. May that light bring us beyond our closed doors. May we respond when love knocks. Amen. Let us join together in our next hymn, Spirit God Be Our Breath. Thank you. as we're invited to move beyond closed doors and share our love with the world, let us imagine gifts that we can each contribute to and for the common good. Sometimes it's not an easy thing. Sometimes it's a really hard task. And our offering song reminds us, you can do this hard thing. It's not easy, I know. You can do this hard thing.
So I'll just give you a small intro, just so that the song maybe ties into the service a bit. I think in some ways it's about resurrection. Certainly it's about friendship, and also about possibilities and faith. So I'm just going to read the bridge and the last verse so that you'll know where we're going from the beginning. I'm giving it away a little bit. Here we stand, breathless and pressed in hard times. Hearts hung like laundry on backyard clotheslines. Impossible just takes a little more time. From the muddy ground comes a green volunteer. In a place we thought barren, new life appears. Morning will come whistling some comforting tune for you. You can do this hard thing.
Said, add these together, carry the two. Now you can do this hard thing. You can do this hard thing. It's not easy, I know, but I believe that it's so. You can do this hard thing. At a cold winter station, breathing into our gloves. It would change me forever, leaving for God knows what. You carried my bags, you said I'll wait for you. You can do this hard thing. You can do this hard thing. It's not easy, I know, but I believe that it's so. You can do this hard thing. Late at night I call, and you answer the phone. The worst it had happened, I did not want to be alone. You quietly listened. You said, we'll see this through. You can do this hard thing. You can do this hard thing. It's not easy, I know. I believe that it's so. You can do this hard thing. Here we stand, breathless and pressed in hard times. Hearts hung like laundry on backyard clotheslines. Impossible just takes a little more time. From the muddy ground comes a green volunteer. In a place we thought barren, new life appears. Morning will come whistling some comforting tune for you. You can do this hard thing. You can do this hard thing. It's not easy, I know, but I believe that it's so. You can do this hard thing.
Amen. That was beautiful. Let us pray. Ever-present God, we desire to walk in the warmth of your sacred light. We testify all that we've seen, heard, and felt. We declare your matchless grace to the rest of creation so that all may hear. Thank you for meeting us where we are. Grant us your peace in the face of uncertainty, and use these gifts for transformation in the world for the common good. Help us to live as those who have encountered the risen Christ. Amen. Thank you. The time in our service where we offer prayers for those in our community and the wider world beyond. You'll be invited in a timeless service while I'll be reading off the names of those who are on our prayer list. You're invited to say out loud or in the silence of your hearts those places and situations that need God's care. Let us pray. Welcome light, love, and hope of God. Surround us with the warmth of the Holy Spirit. Demonstrate your never-ending grace to us. Inspire within us the same grace to offer to others. Enhance our senses to recognize your presence in the world so that we may see, hear, and touch the ways you participate in our everyday lives. Awaken our souls, God, to the injustices that are prevalent within our cultures. Grant us eyes to see those who are overlooked. Grant us ears to hear cries for help. Grant us hands to extend to those in need. May we advocate for the voiceless, the parentless, the homeless, and the disadvantaged. May each of our inactions and actions contribute to the common good. And let us lift up the names of those people and places needing God's care. Patty, Reverend Joelle LeDuc, and family as they mourn the passing of her dad last night. Steve, Lynn, and family. Susan, Joseph, LaShonda, Tyrone, Blair and Leanne and family as they mourn Flo's passing. Richard, Alec and Sandra, Harry, Mike and Jen, Lisa M, Kate, George and Jane, Dorothy, Katie and Robert, the Murphy family, Roy, Addie, Wendy and family, Bonnie and Michael, Terry, Philip, Susan, Joseph, Mariah and family. We lift up those living in the Ukraine, in Gaza, Taiwan, and in Haiti and other places in the world that are struggling without hope. God, infuse empathy in us so that we may offer dignity to those we help. Grant us the wisdom to empower them in the midst of their plights. And may we act out of justice, and may we love mercy. May we walk humbly with you, O God. And in the way Jesus taught us to pray, let us sing his prayer for us and the world. We'll be singing the Our Father out of Voices 959. My servers, Jeff, Lynn, and Mary, to come and join me. And Mark, yes. Not Jeff, Mark. You can just, yeah. This is not our table. This is not the table of Merging Waters. This is not even the table of the United Church of Canada. This is Christ's own table, where all are welcome. All are welcome in love. This is very special. This is my first time offering communion in this community, solo, no supervision. Yay! And I get to wear the stole 2 weeks in a row. Like, how cool is that? Just a bit of logistics. When you're invited, we'll invite you to come forward. We're going to have one station right below the pulpit and one right just before the aisle, not too close to the camera, because then you'll be smothering the people on Zoom. And if you'd like to be served in your seat, just please stay seated. I'll ask the ushers just to take note of that, and one of our servers will come to you in your seat. And the sacrament today offers both gluten and gluten-free options, and the wine that we'll be using is grape juice. Come, not because you are blessed, but because you are hungry. Come, because you know God a little, and you want to know God more. God is present in this sacrament of communion. And let us begin our time of communion celebrating with our communion hymn from Voices United, number 471.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Christ is risen. He is risen. Okay. He's risen indeed. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Holy mystery, that is holy love, you are beyond complete knowledge, above perfect description. Creator, Redeemer, and Holy Spirit, source of life, living word, and bond of love, you are creative and self-giving, generously moving in all the near and distant corners of the universe. Nothing exists that does not find its source in you. Through fear-filled days and aching nights, when the powers of death have done their worst, your love has never deserted us. Even when we turn away from you, you are with us. Your presence never fails. Your gifts of hope and new life transform us. We praise you for Jesus Christ, risen to a life eternal as your love. With the woman at the tomb, we raise the strain of gladness. Hallelujah, life is stronger than death. The day of resurrection has come, scattering fear and gloom. And so we rejoice with all your people of every time and every place, and with angels and archangels to proclaim your glory of your name. It is Jesus, God incarnate, the risen Christ, who joins us together as a community of broken but hopeful believers, loving what he loved, living what he taught, and striving to be his faithful servants in our time and in our place. In this meal, we remember Jesus, we remember his promises, and the price he paid for who he was, what he said, and what he did. On the night before Jesus died, he took a loaf of bread. He gave thanks, and he broke it. And he said, "Take, eat. Whenever you do this, remember me." At supper, Jesus took a cup and he poured it. And he said, "This is the new covenant. Remember me." We do remember. We do remember his life of love, his friendship, his teaching, his dying, and his rising to life again. In sharing this meal, we live out the mystery of our faith. Holy mystery, God of Spirit, we call on you to transform these familiar things. As you continually transform the world around us, bless this bread and bless this cup. The wheat and the grape, the farmer and the harvest, the seed and the sower, so that in the sharing of these simple elements in community, we may taste and see your goodness. Through Christ and in Christ and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, God most holy, now and forever. And together we say, the body of Christ, the bread of life, the lifeblood of Christ, the cup of blessing, the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Thank you, O Christ, for this feast of life. We're fed by your love. We're strengthened by your life. We are sent forth into this world to live your way and share your joy. We're commissioned to feed as we've been fed, forgive as we've been forgiven, and love as we have been loved. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is from More Voices, number 213, Take Up His Song. Before I give the commissioning and the final blessing, and then our choir sings the ascending song, I just want to say a huge thank you, first of all, to our servers, Mark, Mary, and Lynn. To our readers, would have been Patty, but Wendy and Jeff. Lynn, who's ushering today, our whole choir and musical team, and Mark and Myrna and Eric singing. And of course, our amazing tech team, who I can't do this without. Dear friends, brothers, sisters, may your lives reveal the resurrection to the world and be a living testimony of Christ. May you walk in the overwhelming abundance of God's provision. May each action, conscious and subconscious, contribute to the common good. May you live joyfully and love fully with your heart and soul. Go now in the peace and presence of the resurrected Christ. Amen. I'll invite our musical everyone to come on up.
So, actually, have I got some sound on here? Maybe I have, I don't know. I do? Okay, good. So this song, I always thought, growing up, it came along when I was little, and I was, maybe the sunshine, you know, that it feels like sunshine, just the sound of the song. And I thought that was it, you know, it was just a song for the sunshine and that's it. But if you listen really carefully to the verses, there's a lot more to the song, and it ties into everything we've done and said today, quite remarkably. So, actually, Lisa had recommended it for next week. So I took out music, and I started looking at the words and go, holy, this should be this week. It just fits perfectly. So see if you catch on to those connections. with this song.
Weave me the hope of the new tomorrow. Fill my cup.